First Corinthians chapter 5. Sounds like our society today, and I'll stop there.
No.
It is actually reported that there is immorality among you, and immorality of such a kind as does not exist even among the Gentiles, that somebody has his father's wife. Now, I get tickled because it's not wrong, but a lot of the commentators like to make a point of this being his stepmother. And just like today, it could have been a woman his same age or even younger than him. The age difference in marriage was done then as it's done now. But what Paul is saying, even the heathen don't do that. You know, a son does not cohabitate with his father's wife, no matter their age. Of course, David did. And David did with one of his Republican Guard officers.
And sent him to his death.
Well, that's because he had so much character that he wouldn't go see Bathsheba. Mm-hmm. He was pure army. But I only recently got the feeling that Uriah was probably much older than Bathsheba. Because he was one of David's inner sanctum advisory council. Uriah and Bathsheba's dad were part of his advisory council. And Uriah may have married Bathsheba. She may have been a gift from her dad. But I had never thought of that. I had never thought of it. Never gone and compared names. And this is what could have happened here. But Paul is saying, even the heathen don't do this. What are you going to do about it? Kick him out of the church. That's what Paul says to do. You have become arrogant and have not mourned instead, so that the one who has done this deed would be removed from your midst. Do we do that today? Some churches do, some don't. Some talk about it, some take action, most don't. But what Paul says is kick him out of the fellowship so that maybe it'll get his attention to where he can repent and come back into the fellowship. I have decided to deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of his flesh, so that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Now, what does that line say to you? There's a joke that goes with that. You ever heard about the barber? Town barber got sick. And the people who used him for shaving, I can shave myself. So his wife's name was Grace. So while the barber was sick, Grace run the barbershop and did the shaving. And when the barber come back, he saw one of the guys he normally shaved. Came in every day. He said, "No, ever since come to Grace, I haven't need shaving again. My whiskers didn't grow." That's where the saying came, when you're shaved by grace, you're always shaved. But can you see where this line, he said, this man is a sinner, unlike any others. I'm going to turn him over to the devil, so the devil can take his flesh, so that his soul can remain saved. He accepted Christ. He was saved. That's one of the supporting verses of that, I think.
Yeah, our sins can get you kicked out of the heavens. The way it goes about, you're okay. I mean, we would be kicked out.
Yeah, but that's the ones God looks at.
Evidently, that must be that level of intensity or something.
I like the next verse. Your boasting is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump of dough? And I think that's used in one of the Gospels. And the way people interpret it in the Gospels is that a little good will go a long way. That's not to a Jew. That's not what a saying like that ever means. A little dissension. A little dissension. A little off-color comment. Not off-color, just not lovable comment will go through the whole congregation. And I think that's when that's the way leaven in the loaf is used. A little bit will go through the same thing. And I think the comment about the church is like a tree that the birds come and roost in. A lot of people say that the church is an open arms, open hearts, open doors. Not to a Jew. Birds were not good. They're like dogs. A dog to a Jew is not a man's best friend. It's a grubby animal. A bird in your tree is going to poop on the bottom limbs. It's not good. I think what it's saying is that you're going to have everybody in your congregation that are not. The bad ones are going to be like this guy with his dad's wife. Clean out the old leaven so that you may be a new lump, just as you are in fact unleavened. For Christ, our Passover, also has been sacrificed. Yeah. Now what would at Passover they would buy some fresh leaven so we could clean it out, some fresh yeast, because everything, they would sell anything that might have touched yeast, then buy it back after Passover, but we'd get rid of it for Passover, get it out of the house. So leaven is never a good sign in anything dealing with Jewishness. Therefore, let us celebrate the feast not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. I did not mean all need. I'm not sure what that phrase means. I don't know if it's a mistake in spelling.
Where you at?
I'm looking.
Nine?
Could be, it's nine. Yeah, nine. Verse 10. I did not mean at all mean with the immoral people. Let's see what some other. But I wasn't talking about all unbelievers who indulge in sexual sin or are greedy or cheat people or worship idols. You would have to leave this world to avoid people like that. In no way did I mean the immoral people of this world, or the greedy, or the swindlers, or the idolaters, since you would have to get out of the world.
Now, a lot of that had to do with him thinking that Jesus was coming right away.
Yeah.
That you didn't need the marriage bed and everything that went along with that.
Yeah, when we get to that part of marriage, that's what he was thinking about. But here he's talking about not associating with immoral people. I wrote to you in my letter, they don't know what letter he's referring to, not to associate with immoral people. I did not at all mean with immoral people. Okay, now, this is the arrangement of the words in this translation. I did not at all mean with the immoral people of this world. Or with the covetous, the swindlers, or with the idolaters. For then you would have to go out of the world. But actually, I wrote you not to associate with any so-called brother if he is an immoral person, or covetous, or an idolater, or a reviler, or a drunkard, or a swindler. Not even to eat with such a one. In other words, you have to deal with them. He's saying, you're going to be in the world, and those people are going to be in the world.
Just don't associate.
Just don't have them to your church supper. Especially don't have them for Lord's supper. See, he gets into that a little bit later, too. These people have trouble with communion. For those who are outside, God judges. Remove the wicked man from among yourselves. In other words, Paul is a firm believer, at least for the early church, in excommunication. Okay, that was chapter 5. Let's stop there. We'll take up chapter 6.